So how are you doing today, Tam?
I'm doing great. How about you?
I am marvelous.
Awesome.
Want to thank you for spending a little bit of time with us. Like I said, I think it's pretty important. At least it is to me. You know, we see all these people's names out there, Tam Vapes being one of them. And I thought it would be neat to just kind of get to know the mixer a little better.
Right, absolutely.
I mean, we've seen you on a DIY Down Under mixing with me, mate. You're there almost every week like I am. But so we kind of know you, but we don't know you. So, and if I ask you anything that you don't want to answer, just tell me that you don't want to answer it. I don't care. So let's start this way. Besides vaping, what else do you like to do? What else does Tam like to do?
Oh, besides vaping. Well, I have two little dogs, puppies that keep me quite busy. I have a tweenie and a dachshund that are like both under 10 pounds each. So they're like miniature dogs. So I enjoy them. I enjoy chilling out.
Right.
I'm kind of boring. I'm one of those boring people. I don't have a really exciting life. I always joke and tell people I live vicariously through their Facebook page when they post pictures going out and they're partying, and like that's how I live, is through their Facebook page.
That's a lot safer.
Yeah, I'm kind of like my boyfriend. He does what you do. He's an over-the-road truck driver. So he's gone during the week. He's home on the weekends. But then he's got all of his things that he likes to do, like hunting, race car driving, fishing. So basically that keeps him busy when he's off work too.
Right.
So basically I'm either waiting for him. But I also have children that I spend time with too. So they're not really little anymore. They're like 14, 16.
Well, that's probably the most important time. Not always the most pleasant time to spend time with them, but it's the time that you need to spend with them.
Right. But my son is just amazing. I just spent the whole weekend with him. And he is like cleaning house for me. He's like, we put together a filing cabinet and we were using the drill and stuff. And he's like, Mom, how did you learn how to do all this? And I'm like, from your grandfather, that's how. So it's really cool to spend time with the kids and teach them stuff like that. Yeah.
Absolutely. I've seen on a couple of your recipes that you get some inspiration from music.
Yes, I love music.
What kind
always
of music?
Have. I love all kinds of music. And I think it started mostly when I was growing up. My dad always played me. Everywhere we went, my dad played music in the car. 8-track tapes. Back then is what we had. And I mean, he used to play anything and everything from those old trucking songs to just silly songs like kid songs to Johnny Cash, a lot of country, Tammy Wynette. So we always joke that's who I was named after, Tammy Wynette. I grew up in the South here in Georgia, near Atlanta. So, of course, I grew up, and my family, we listened to country music. And as soon as I was old enough to have my own decisions, I started listening to rap music, hip-hop music. I was a big Salt-N-Pepa fan. Before anybody even knew who they were. And So I've always loved, I can listen to about any kind of music, bluegrass, hip hop, rap, country. Because John, my boyfriend, he is a big country music person. But I love alternative music. Like old school Nirvana, old school, especially old school alternative back from the early 90s, stuff like that. But I love Joni Mitchell. Songs that have a story to tell.
Right.
That's really.
I'm kind of that same way. I listen to music based on the mood that I'm in.
Yeah, that's kind of, yeah, I think that's it too, the mood.
Sets the tone. I'm really big into listening to the lyrics of songs.
Yes, the lyrics speak volumes. Like, yeah, exactly. Alanis Morissette got me through the mid-90s big time.
Right.
My Man Hating Days, which I still have some days. But, yeah, she... nothing against you, but she really got me through a lot of times in the mid-90s. Oh, my gosh. I went through Jagged Little Pill, like two CDs, I think, listening to that.
Mm-hmm. That was a pretty good album, though.
Yeah, it was.
I like that
album. Oh, and oh, my gosh. Who else is the other one back then? Wow, there's so many good ones. I can't remember the other girl's name, but I was a big female. And Jewel back then. I don't know if you remember Jewel before she went country. I loved her music and a lot of good artists like that. Really great.
I'm sure. Well, now I know we have that in common. Yeah. I'm sure. I think most people like music to some degree.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I do. My dad's always been like that. My mom, I think she's could be like, just turn the crap off.
Right.
But yeah, most people, yeah, I think so.
So how long have you been vaping?
Vaping? Since mid-2013.
Okay.
Is that right? Yes. Mid-2013, I got to think about that. Yes, that's right. Mid to late 2013. And there's kind of an interesting story with that. Because I had been a smoker I didn't smoke when I was a teenager, like most people, because I knew if I came home and had been smoking as a teenager, I would have been murdered by my mother. Because she waited up and would smell me, see my eyes. Everything, she would have known it in 2 seconds. So I didn't really explore my wild oats, if you want to say, till I was like in my mid-20s. In my mid-20s, that's kind of when I was like, oh my gosh, there's bars out here and there's men and there's and to be cool, you got to smoke a cigarette because everybody smoked at the bar. And so, yeah, so that's when I started smoking cigarettes. And lo and behold, I liked it. I like smoking my cigarettes.
Right.
And not just at the bar. I like smoking them on coffee breaks, lunch breaks, at work, in the car, just all the time. And I had my Camel that came in the tin can. They were the Turkish flavored Camels. And they were like my favorites. Oh my gosh, I love those things. Okay, so then I got pregnant with my first child at 30, 31. And so I did not smoke all while I was pregnant, but I could not wait to get a cigarette when I was after I had her. And so as soon as I had her, I would go outside and smoke. And so I picked it right back up. Then I had my son 2 years later, and I stopped smoking the minute I found out I was pregnant, but then I would start back afterwards. So it was crazy how I could stop and then start back. So,
my,
yeah, so that was just, Kind of crazy.
My ex-wife did the same thing with R2. And it, at the time I didn't smoke, but it's amazing to me the memory that we have of what smoking that cigarette was like. So
yeah.
you can go 8 or 9 months without a cigarette, and then
right.
as soon as you can, that opportunity comes back. That's what you want.
Yeah, exactly. And so, then, yeah, I'm not trying to take
over. No, you're fine. But,
and then I got, I had a third child. But I had actually quit. I actually quit smoking before I even got pregnant with my third child. And it was my youngest son was 4 years old when I got pregnant with my third child. So I had been stopped smoking for about 2 years, probably about 2 years I had stopped. And I think the doctor had put me on Wellbutrin, and that's what made me stop smoking, was that, which is, I think, the same thing as Shantex.
Right.
Wellbutrin, yeah, it's pretty much the same thing. So I had got the, oh, I don't feel like smoking anymore, isn't this weird? But it was from that drug, and I didn't even realize that that was doing that. So I had quit. And anyway, 1 week after I had my third child, I had a brain hemorrhage, a really bad headache. And it was a brain hemorrhage, basically. I had a brain bleed. I had a bleed in my right frontal lobe, inside the right hemisphere, and also in the lining of the brain, which is between the skull and the right frontal lobe. I had a bleed there.
Right.
So the bleeds were bleeding. Both the bleeds were bleeding. And so I had a 1 week old baby, and I had a headache from absolute hell. but didn't realize what was going on. Go to the emergency room and they do a CAT scan, and they're like, there's something going on up here and we don't know. We're going to have to intubate.
Right.
Basically put you in an induced coma so we can keep her still and stop the swelling, in the brain, because it's causing damage. Any kind of bleeding is cutting off oxygen in the brain, and it's causing swelling. And it's cause anytime you turn off oxygen in the brain and swelling is happening, you're causing brain damage.
Right.
So they had to put me in an induced coma, and they did all the scans, and they realized I had those two bleeds, and they were able to give me medication to make the one in the right frontal lobe to stop bleeding, which if they couldn't have got that one to stop, there wouldn't have been much they could have done, because you can't really slice into the brain and get something to stop bleeding. Right. That's bleeding. But the one in the lining, they could not get to stop. So they had to cut me open like a big horseshoe here. I had a beautiful horseshoe incision. Anyway, so once they opened up my skull, they said immediately it clotted, the bleed clotted. So it was like a miracle happened. It clotted. And so then they put the skull back on, because luckily there wasn't that much. They got the swelling to stop enough where they were able to put the skull back on. So I have like 4 metal plates, 20 titanium screws holding those in place. And so they said it was caused from an AVM, anterior ventricle malformation, which is where the veins and the, I don't know what it's called, veins in your artery. Am I saying this right? The veins in the artery, you can have an AVM in a few different places, but if it's in the brain, where a vein and the artery come together,
right.
You know, where the blood's flowing, but they're tangled. Basically, and they say you're usually born with it, and there's not a lot that you can do about it, and you don't usually know about it until it explodes.
Right.
And a lot of times when you have it, it becomes, it'll start to leak and it'll become weak, and you'll develop an aneurysm in the subarachnoid area, which is where I had the second bleed on the outside.
Right.
Where they had to do they had to open up the skull and stop that bleed. So that's why I had two. I had the AVM on the inside that exploded, and then I had a aneurysm on the lining that exploded. So they both like went kaboom. And it was, they basically exploded. And I know that sounds like morbid. Oh, it exploded. It's no big deal. At this point, it'll be 10 years, October 16th, that it happened. So, you know, to me, it's like old news now. But, so anyway, because of it, I'm starting to lose track of where I was in my story. So, because of it, I did suffer a little bit of brain, if you want to call it brain damage, which isn't horrible because I'm alive, you know. I could be way worse off, worse off than what I am, because most people who have this thing happen to them don't survive. They don't make it to the hospital in time. And then when they do get to the hospital, they're lucky if they're at a hospital that is equipped to take care of that kind of an emergency. And right. I did both. I was at a hospital that had that kind of a emergency team there, and I made it to the hospital. And so, and with my age at the time, I was 36, 37, I don't, 37. I was 37 at the time, because I'm 47 now, and it was 10 years ago. Okay. I was 37. And so with my age, your brain's still very placid, which means plasticky, not plastic, but it's very, you know, it's jello.
Right, right.
You know, so it's still able to grow new connections. In there, it's not like a miracle where it's going to just automatically grow them. But if you rework things and practice things a lot, it can create some new connections in there. So basically, when I woke up from this coma I was in, my whole entire left side was paralyzed. My leg, my face. And you can see when you watch me and I smile, you can tell my face on this side is droopier than this side. But it's just part of who I am now. And this shoulder, when I stand up, is droopier than this side. And this arm, and most people don't ever see it. It's shooting a bird right now. I have to move it. It has a mind of its own, this hand. This hand does not work. And it's probably the biggest pain in my career today is this hand. It's basically, it looks deformed because it kind of crooks in, and it has no, I can't move it. Sometimes I can control the fingers a little bit, but not really. The arm I can move a little bit, but not much. And it's my left arm, and I was right-handed, so I was very fortunate with that. But I went to rehab not soon after that, and I rolled into rehab at Shepherd Center in Atlanta, which is the leading spinal institute in Georgia and probably the Southeast for people with spinal injuries. But they also have an excellent department for people with acquired brain injuries. So I rolled in on a stretcher. 5 weeks later, I walked out on my own 2 feet.
Wow.
Yeah, so it was a miracle. It was a miracle that happened in that place. And I know, you know, a lot of people are like, oh, I don't believe in miracles. And I wouldn't argue with anybody about whether or not miracles happen or not. But for me, I believe in miracles in my own special way. So yeah, a miracle happened to me. Yes.
Absolutely.
A miracle happened to me when the bleed clotted when they opened my skull. And when I was able to learn how to walk again at Shepherd Center, because at first they tell me I'd be in a wheelchair the rest of my life. Now it's like, nope, I'm not.
I'm not having that.
No, I'm not doing that. But I did have to settle for the fact that I will not wear my funky high heels anymore, because I love to wear high heels and funky. Yeah, I know.
Not really.
And it's so frustrating because I go to the store and I'm shopping for boots and sandals, and there's all these cute heels and everything, and I can't buy them. I can't even try them on because I would fall flat on my face with them. Because even though I can walk fairly well and people don't notice that my balance may not be as great, they don't notice this, but I don't have the balance I used to.
Right.
So it's just little things like that. It's taken me 10 years to really come to grasp with all of this sometimes, that I have to wear ugly nurse shoes. No offense against nurses, but like, I just bought some new Skechers because I didn't want to wear tennis shoes all the time. So I bought some new Skechers that are called walk-in shoes. I don't know, but they're black slip-ons that are in the sneaker department, but they're cute little shoes and they feel like gloves on my feet, and I'm not going to slip and fall in them.
Well, as long as they're comfortable, that's important.
Yeah, but I don't really care who likes them anymore or who doesn't. But to me, I'm not going to fall and bust my ass, you know?
Right. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, so it's just little things like that. And it took a long time. They had to shave my head when I was in the hospital, when they did my surgery. And because of all the blood that was matted up in the rest of my hair, they ended up shaving my whole head. And for a long time, I was angry at the whole world about them shaving my head, because to a female with hair, that is very, you don't realize how vain you are about your hair when you don't, until you don't have it.
Right.
Then you're like, yeah, you realize just how vain you are about your hair and your appearance until you don't have it. And so that was a tough one. Was getting through growing a bald head out with a big horseshoe scar in it.
Right. Well,
yes. Yeah, so.
I got this way via a bet. Now I was thinning out, but I wasn't bald on top. And I lost a bet, and the bet was if I lost, I would shave my head. And so I shaved my whole head, and this is all that grew back.
Wow. Now see, John, his hairline's about like you, but his has been like that, I think, since he was in his early 30s.
Yeah.
It's been like,
my son's in his late 20s and he's already losing it on top.
Wow. It's just hereditary.
Yeah.
And then I went to get my hair done like a couple of months ago, and I had my hair pushed back. And I have this widow's peak kind of thing going, you know, like the Dracula thing.
Right.
And she's like, please don't wear your hair back like that. Please don't do that. Because it makes your forehead look big. And she's like telling me these things about making me feel even worse. You have this thing, this widow's peak, and it makes your forehead look even bigger. And I'm like, really, lady? Oh, my gosh. All right, well, I won't come back here. Okay. I always loved my widow's peak because my dad has one. But where I was going with the whole thing about vaping, because you asked me about how I got into vaping. Well, after all of this drama happened in my life, 5 years later, I stayed away from the stinkies, okay, because I had all this bull crap happening. But I did drink wine, and it didn't take me long to realize I didn't need to be drinking. And on some of I have to take certain medications because of the bull crap that happened.
Right.
But it didn't take me long to realize I don't need to be drinking and have this stuff happen to me. And so anyway, way, I stopped the drinking, and a year later, I guess maybe I wasn't as pleasant anymore. I wasn't as fun. I don't know. But my husband at the time decided he didn't like me as much, probably because I was so different than what I, because I am. I'm totally different than I was pre-brain injury, pre this. So he left. We got a divorce. And that was a very stressful time 5 years ago. Very stressful. And so I was really going through some hard times. So I was either about to start smoking again or start drinking. Well, I mean, I'm not saying like I had this ultimatum. I was going to do one or the other, but I could feel that it was going to be something was going to happen. And then I found vaping. I'm like, oh, what is this? You know, what is this? So I don't have to smoke and I can do this and this is better for me. And if I get like frustrated and mad, I can sit and vape instead of smoke a cigarette or drink a glass of whatever. I can have a vape.
Right.
And so that's what I grabbed, and this became my addiction, if you can't tell. Because apparently I have that personality, obviously, an addictive personality where whatever I do, I have to do it all the way.
Right.
And
right.
I do it with my whole heart. And
absolutely.
This is one of those things. And
so let me ask you this. When you started vaping, if your liquid mm-hmm. was unflavored or just tasted like tobacco or something, would you have kept vaping, you think? Or do you think that you would have
kept
cigarettes?
No, I would have went and found my Camel Turkish Delight or Turkish Gold or whatever they were called. No, I liked my flavors.
I don't think I've ever heard anybody ask you this. How many concentrates do you have? Rough guess.
1,300.
Wow.
I'm rounding it.
And
it's how insane. Long,
how long have you been mixing?
Okay. Whenever the government started their bull crap and they were going to start all these regulations and 2006, hold on, what year were we in? 2016, that they were going to start this crap where August 8th, remember that?
Right. Yeah.
2016?
Yeah.
I started ordering my stuff before then. So 2016.
Wow.
Yeah. That's, so a little over 2 years, not that long, not as long as a lot of people, but long enough to get in trouble.
Right. And how did it feel when you made your first recipe that you were just like, wow, I made that. This is really good.
It was just the first time I actually made a recipe following a recipe from ELR, and I vaped it and I was like, this is better than what I bought at the shop. And I was just so excited, and I don't get super excited about a lot of things, but things like that, that got me excited. That got me pumped. That really got me pumped. And I was like, if everybody knew, and I wanted to go tell everybody, like, if you guys only knew, this is what it was in the juice and how easy it is to do this, and you could be saving money and saving your life at the same time, and all you have to do is buy a couple of concentrates. You don't have to buy a whole lot. You don't have to be crazy like me. I'm crazy. But you can just buy a few concentrates and some VG and PG and your nicotine, and you're good. You don't have to go buy $30 shop juice. You can buy $30 worth of supplies and be set for like 6 months probably.
Right.
I mean, yeah, so I wanted to go tell everybody, and everybody's looking at me like, oh, okay.
Now the tough question. Have you single flavor tested all of those?
Hell no.
Okay. Because I don't know. I would still be like on bottle number 30.
Yeah. Yeah, hell no. I mean, you know, You know, it's just like, okay. Certain, you single flavored, here's my, okay, I'm going to get in so much trouble.
No, there is no trouble.
No, I'm just, you know what I mean. You single flavor test strawberries, and you know what a strawberry tastes like in a strawberry. And so, but you still need to know what each strawberry is different. They're not all the same. They're totally different. So you still need to single flavor test them, but you don't have to single flavor test them. For me, anyway, I wouldn't tell a new person this. So don't do what I do. Do what I say. No. But once you've got your groundwork for your basic single flavor testing, your basic strawberries, and you know what they taste like, or they're going to taste like in a mix, then I can start taking a basic mix of like maybe vanilla ice cream from Liquid Barn and maybe another cream and do a strawberry in it. And I can pick up on what that strawberry is.
Right.
Instead of having to do that single flavor test on every single strawberry. Right. That makes sense?
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. Yeah, and that's what I was going to say. Once you've tested so many flavors, you know how those flavors work. And you're going to have worked with them, with each other. So when you get something new, you can add the new thing to that because you know how this tastes. Well, now I'm adding this to it, and so this is what this flavor
is. You know where it's going. Now, when I get a new vendor, like Sasami, I've never used before. And even if I read all the ELR notes, because there's not that many, I need to single flavor test that. Maybe not every single... like fruit, but right. Like the cakes and pastries, that needs to be single flavor tested for sure.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. And I think that's really important too. The fruits, not so much, because like you said, kind of a strawberry is a strawberry. But when it comes to the cakes and the desserts and the pastries, there's so many subtleties.
Right.
In those mixes. And you never know that, you know, like I just released that cocoa cake today.
I need to check that out too.
I found out that the Liquid Barn lava cake at 6% with 1% of 1-on-1 powdered sugar, you don't get a powdered sugar note, but what you get is a cocoa note. So like you bake the chocolate cake and then sprinkled the outside of it with a lightly sweetened cocoa. It even leaves that little dry texture in your mouth at the end of the vape.
Interesting.
But if you don't test this stuff.
Yeah, you don't know.
You could stumble across it by accident, you know.
Right.
But so just so there's no illusions here for anybody else. Do you still find recipes that you want to mix that somebody else made that you don't have all the flavors for?
Oh, absolutely. Every day.
See?
Every day.
1,300.
Every day.
1,300 concentrates and still got to buy.
I still don't have them all. No. That's crazy. Every day, there's still something. And it's like, really? It's like, what? It's just something basic like Flavor West white chocolate. You know, just something really basic. You would think, why don't I have that one? Or why don't I have, you know, whatever it is. Capella, trying to think of one. Caramel, I don't know. I think I might have that now. But just little ones, like, I need to call them up and tell them there's a better caramel so they can switch this up. No, not really. I'm teasing.
Yeah. Well, see, that's like me. I went for a long time without buying any flavors. So I mean, I just last month picked up like Flavor Wild Melon. Barn Lava Cake. I just picked that up last month. That's been out for what, a couple of years?
Yeah. A lot of what I did a year ago was I just started mixing a lot of other people's recipes. And that, I think, for me, helped me grow a lot as a mixer. And I grew my inventory a lot. But some of, like, I mixed a lot from ID10T.
Right.
I even bought Dang Pickle to mix his Pickle Rick.
I've been tempted. I still haven't done it.
Oh, yeah, I did that. I went through everything. I mixed a lot of his Concrete Rivers. So I grew my Flavora line a lot just from mixing a lot of people like that. And I'm trying to think who. Oh, even Chemist. You know Chemist from E-Juice Makers?
I do.
He got me. I fell in love with RY4 Double just from mixing his recipe. He has one recipe that I used to mix it by 500 milliliters at a time. Southern Smoke.
Really?
I think that's what it's called, Southern Smoke. Oh, my word. If you can't find the recipe, if it's hidden, let me know. I have it.
Okay.
All right. It is absolutely delicious. It's RY4 Double with caramels and things like that. It is one of my favorites that I used to mix all the time. I think it's a one shot now somewhere.
All right. I'm a big fan of the RY4 Doubles. I have not made a recipe that I like using it, but I found other recipes that I absolutely love with it.
Oh, yeah. And then he has a lot of recipes with RY4 Double, a lot of them. And I mixed a lot of his recipes with RY4 Double. And so Chemist, ID10T, Concrete River, and of course our famous boy, Shindo.
Shindo,
Sticky
yeah.
Rice. Yeah, I mixed. A year ago, I was mixing all of that stuff. So I was, you know, mixed. So a lot of everybody's mixes you, to me, I learned something from anyone I mix from. I don't think I'm stealing anything from anyone, but I'm learning.
Oh, no. And
yeah.
I think, and that's one thing that I really like about Pippa and being a part of the DIY Down Under Facebook group.
Yeah.
And being on the Mixing With Me Mate show is geared towards sharing your knowledge with other people.
Yeah, and especially Fresho 3. Oh my gosh. And I feel, what do I feel? How did I not find him sooner? Like, I don't know how he was hidden under my radar for so long. But he was hidden under my radar for a long time.
Right.
I
didn't know anything about him. I found Wayne Walker first.
Yes, me too. Wayne Walker. New Amsterdam Vapes. I watched a lot of his YouTube videos.
Right. I found Wayne, and then I stumbled across somehow a video of a guy mixing the juice in his garage in Florida. The name of that juice was called Panty Dropper. He used to have a line, but it's a strawberry cream. It's really good. But from there, something underneath that video is how I found Fresh.
Wow. Yeah. I know some people that owe Fresh for everything. And I'm like, wow, how did I miss falling under that rock? But I have to say, if it weren't Wayne, I followed Wayne straight from the beginning and followed his website, have been a member of his DIY or Die, and followed him on YouTube. And I even took one of his courses he did and met some really cool people, one being Folk Art, and actually did a big project with Folk Art a little over a year ago that we did. And so I've met some really awesome, cool people over my, I don't know what you call it, my obsession with DIY.
Right.
I mean, some awesome people. And I don't know any other hobby or project that I've ever been involved with that I have met such a cool group of people. We'd do anything for you.
Absolutely. And that's what I love about it. I can't talk much now. Any group, you know, you've got people that aren't necessarily the nicest and all that, but overall,
I could go, yeah.
Vape people are just great. And I'm actually thinking about going to Vegas so I can meet Fresh and them.
You know, I hear that I personally would love to go to Vegas just to meet these people, but I don't know that I could do the crowd because I get all part of my new, what is it? I hate to say I have a disability. Isn't that a horrible thing to say I have a disability? But I mean, I guess that's what it is. But in one way, my disability has heightened other abilities within me.
Right.
So, you know, I go out and I meet people and I feel like I can be an inspiration to other people where before I couldn't do that. And so that's kind of what I like to achieve, be to people. If I can, I mean, I don't need to be the best mixer that's out there. That's, you know, let other people do that. I want to be able to mix for me and stay off stinkies and stay off having to buy the vape shop juices. But I also would like to help share what I know to other people who are trying to learn how to mix well. And just share that knowledge. And I feel like I can do that and be an inspiration as well. That's what I would like to do.
Right.
So, my new disabilities, I don't do well in big crowds. Let's put it that way.
Right.
I can do okay in a big crowd on YouTube, but not so much in public.
Right.
Like going to Walmart, totally can't do it. Don't do it unless it's just the dead zone.
Right.
We're all there.
Right.
So I don't do a lot of grocery. If I go shopping, it's online shopping and I'm a hermit. That's why I said I don't have an exciting life. I live vicariously through other people. I would love to go to, I'm envious of everyone who's going to get to meet the people that they've become such good friends with through social media and YouTube and things like that. I'm very envious of that. I would love to meet you guys, Mary Beth, Pippa, Daytime Frank. It would just be amazing to me. I would just sit and cry.
Yeah.
To be able to meet all you guys. I would be like, this is just so amazing. You know? So I just am so envious of that.
I know you're gonna have a good time too. I thought I was going to get to meet Daytime Frank last weekend, and then we ended up in different locations. Now, this weekend, I'm sitting where he was last weekend.
Wow. And now he's
somewhere else. So that just didn't work out, but it'll happen eventually.
Oh, yeah, it will. It will.
All right. It will. One other question I do have for you.
Okay. And this
will make you think a little bit.
Oh, crap.
Is there a concentrate that you wish was available to us that, you know, maybe it exists, but it's not any good, or maybe it doesn't exist at all. Just some flavor that you wish we had that we could utilize. So I guess what I'm asking is if you could contact, say, Wonder Flavors or from Laura and say, you got to make this flavor, what would it be?
Interesting. Wow. That is a good question there. Any flavor? I'm trying to think. That is a really good one because what is it I've had one day and I was like, if only I could make that. And I don't know how I'd make it. You should know I don't think good on my feet. I'm not a quick thinker.
Well, here's the problem. I asked you the question, which means I wrote the question, and I still don't have an answer for myself to that question.
Okay, well, good. So I don't know. I don't know. I kind of feel like whatever it is I want to do, I find ways to do it through all the concentrates that I do have. It's really not much out there that's not able to do. I don't, but I guess there is always. But like today, for instance, I'm like, you know, I want to do an all-flavora thing. And I found this cool recipe and, or not a recipe, like a, I'm talking like a real recipe. Right. I look at real recipes and I look at how I can turn them into a vape, you know? And I'm like, okay, there's no butter pecan in flavora, you know? Am I missing it? There's not, right?
I don't think there is.
No, there's no butter pecan. There's no pecan. There's like praline and there's butterscotch and there's caramel and toffee and but beer nuts and but no butter pecan. So I was like, if I wanted to do a butter pecan something in flavora, I'm missing that note, you know, that butter right. pecan. So I'm like, okay, Flavora, you need to step up on butter pecan. So that would be one I would call Flavora and say, we need a butter pecan.
Okay. I know I know on Fresh's show today, Flavora is fixing to release some new flavors. And I know...
Yeah, that would be cool.
I don't remember what's in there, but I think there was a nut in there of some kind. I just don't... It wasn't butter pecan, but it might have been pecan.
Yeah, even if it's a pecan, you can still like work with it, like with a caramel and a
right, right.
butterscotch, and smoked butterscotch, and
if you were gonna ask, or if you would want, if you were gonna recommend a couple of your recipes for people to go out and check out the mix, what would they be? Have any idea?
A couple of mine.
Yeah.
Well, ones that people have really loved, that I like a lot and that aren't that hard to get concentrates for. I guess that's what I always, like some of my favorite ones kind of are difficult to get concentrates for. Like one of my absolute favorites is Cookie Chow, which has calipiter chow in it, which you can only get that concentrate from Chef's Flavors right. in the UK. But as far as concentrates that are readily available, I suggest my fried butterscotch ice cream is one of my favorites that I've made. And it was about a year ago, not quite a year ago, but close to a year ago that I did that one. And I'm trying to think what else. 50 Shades of Cream? It's really good. I just made 500 mils of that today. And the only thing probably hard to get in that, which really isn't, you have to get it at OS DIY. It's the Lucky Shot.
Right. That Lucky Shot is a great flavor.
Oh, it is absolutely amazing, Lucky Shot. Absolutely amazing. Where did I just put it? Did I put it back? Oh, yeah, did I put it back? Yeah, look, I had a, look, this big 100. Look, it's half gone. I need some more already. I can tell. Absolutely. When I get that low on my Lucky Shot, I need to get more.
It's time to order.
Some of my other ones would be, if you like a little bit of a tobacco, would be to do my Holy Smoke. And that has Sticks Mix in it. And you have to have Holy Holy Grail for that.
Okay.
But that is amazing. And it has a lot of flavora, like smoked butterscotch in it. And caramel and graham cracker, I think.
Okay. Well, Tam, and I've been wanting to tell you this for quite a while. And once I decided that I wanted to do these videos, I figured I would wait till now to tell you, but I do find you to be very inspirational.
Thank you.
Just to me as a person, we see people whine all the time about stuff that they can't do or how hard it is.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I'm like you, I don't think that I don't consider you to have a disability because you work around it. I mean, you have found ways to do what you want to do. You mix liquid, you
re-wick. I build my coils.
Right. You re-wick and you build your coils. So if people can't find that kind of inspiring, you know, then I don't know what to say. So.
Well, thank you. That's a lot.
Absolutely.
Ask for it.
Absolutely.
Ask for it. It's just.
If people wanted to go check you out, where could they find you?
I am at All the Flavors and on ELR as Tam Vapes. TAMVAPES, Tam Vapes.
All right.
So that. And on Facebook, I'm Tammy Olson, OLSN.
Right. And you hang and out I in a bunch. Out. Yeah, I was going to say.
I hang out in a bunch of places. Any, like most DIY e-juice places. I'm an admin in DIY Down Under. And I really have. A bit, I love ESMR. ESMR. Yeah.
Yeah.
Eat, Sleep, Mix, Repeat. That group has a bit, I have a big heart for that place because of, okay, here's where you're going to see the little cranks in there start going slower. And I can't see, sometimes I retrieve the wrong, and I'll say the wrong words. But if you were to have seen me a year ago on video versus now, I have come like trillions of miles. I have come a long way because I've really been working on talking and my speech. Right. And I don't always give the right eye contact. I close my eyes a lot more than I should. But my speech is a lot better than it used to be as far as talking on camera, just so you know.
Right. Right.
Because before I was very choppy and really couldn't come up with my words at all. But I've been, because that was a big problem that I've had, was with my speech being very fluid. And so I've been working on that. Well, so.
Doing great as far as I'm concerned, Tam. Well, anyway, again, I want to thank you for doing this today.
Oh, but thank you for having me and for offering to do it. I was telling my son that I said, I'm going to go do an interview. He's like, what? I said, yeah, remember? Because we went out on my birthday. No, this summer, me and him and my oldest daughter went out to, oh gosh, I don't know, IHOP. And they said, wouldn't it be funny, Mom, if somebody came up and said, there's Tam Vapes. I said, yeah, Christopher, I'm getting that famous. I'm doing interviews. And I was just being funny, you know, with him. And so, anyway, that was a joke. But but no, thank you so much. But, you know, I found you on YouTube, and it's been such a pleasure getting to know you.
Well, thank you.
Such a pleasure.
Thank you. Absolutely.
You are awesome. You are awesome and have come a long way with your videos.
They're a little different now than what they used to be, that's for sure.
Yes. You're doing an absolutely fantastic job. And I'm envious of you for doing this because it's something I wish I could, and maybe one day I will do them. But right now it's not in my ballpark to do that. But you are doing a great job and I love it. Keep it up.
All right. Great.
In the description of this video, there will be a link to Tam Vapes, All the Flavors, and Tam Vapes profile on ELR. So when you follow this link, this is what you should see. All right, so the All the Flavors link should take you to here. As you can see, she's got 92 recipes. She's sharing 39 of them on All the Flavors. There's that cookie chow that she was talking about. Okay, and you can go through. I do recommend in mixing you all that that 50 Shades of Cream. I have mixed that one. It's very good. One needs a 4 or 5 day steep. I'm not sure what she puts on it steep-wise. I know 4 or 5 days I was able to vape it. This is her profile on ELR. And so this is what she has on there. Here is the 50 Shades of Cream. Okay, everybody, so that was Tam Vapes. Hope you enjoyed the video. Like I said, I would just like to get to know some more about these mixers, and I hope y'all do too. Now, if there's a mixer that you all would like to get to know some more, put a comment in the link, and I'll try to get in contact with them and see if I can set something up. Also, if you have specific questions that you would like to know from a mixer, just leave it in the comments under this video, or you can email me at vapintrucker, VAPINtrucker, all one word, 01@gmail.com. Okay. So, you know, let's make this fun. Let me know who you want to know more from and what questions that you want them to answer. And we'll see if we can make it happen. So until next time, y'all, keep trucking, keep vaping, and stay safe. Y'all have a good day. Thanks.